partake in communion with us. So why don't we go ahead and worship the Lord this morning? Come on, you have come.
You have come. We have found life everlasting.
Praise,
oh hallelujah,
we give thanks.
people in the house, give him praise. Glory, hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. My soul cries out, yes. You've been so good. You've been so good. I thank you, Lord. I thank you. My heart is full. My heart is full. I love you, Lord.
Here.
You are here.
You are here.
You're mending every heart.
promise keeper, the light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Waymaker,
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God, that is who you are.
Yes, that is who you are.
Thank you. This cup is a new covenant in my blood. Do this whenever you drink in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread or drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And as we take this, let's remember all that he did for us. You know what? We are so blessed in so many ways. And as you take this, take it with a thought of, thank you, Jesus, for all that you've done. Go ahead and take it. You know, I asked Steva if we could come out during Waymaker because he made a way. He made a way for each one of us. Steva, let's go ahead and do that chorus again.
Come on, if you want to stand to your feet and sing it with us.
Waymaker, miracle worker, promise keeper, light in the darkness, my God.
Thank you for making a way for us, God, when we didn't even see a way, God. You're always there for us, and you're always with us, and we thank you. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated.
I just had to stop the video to let you know signups are available for Love Week 2020. You don't want to miss it. It is the week September 28th through October 2nd. Guys, we are so looking forward to this. Can't wait for you to sign up. Just go to gtchurch.com and sign up today. Or if you're watching on Facebook or YouTube, you can click on the link in the descriptions. Hey, before you get back to the video, don't forget we also have New Life's Baby Bottle Campaign. So if you had a baby bottle, please bring it back so that we can help support New Life Pregnancy Center.
Well, hello, my beautiful family! All right, I literally just came out to say three words before Pastor Jordan, encourages you to give in the offering today. Three very profound words, okay? I'll be back.
I didn't know that was happening. But how are you guys doing today? Good, good, good. Well, I get the pleasure of doing the offering with you guys today, and I just wanted to keep today short and sweet. We give because God is good. We come here because God is good. We worship because God is good. Life can throw a lot of different things at you. It will. But we are here each and every day by the grace of God. You have a family here that cares for you, that loves you, that at a moment's notice you can call this place and it will swarm you with love. When I first got here from Seattle, I was so impressed by how many people came up to me and just said, hey, what do you need? I can bring you food. I can help you move in. It was just over and over and over and over. You don't get that everywhere you go. That's the character of God shining through GT. We want to see that continue to grow and develop in each and every one of you. And so we give to keep pushing forward the kingdom of heaven. And ultimately, even if this life leaves you broken and battered, there is an eternity that God has set up for you where there's no more pain, there's no more suffering, there's no more doubt, there's no more fear, because he is good. And because of that, we choose to give back so that we can increase the glory of his name. And so I just wanted to remind you of that today, because I need that reminder sometimes when I'm having a rough week, when there's 2,000 kids jumping up on me, like, Pastor Jordan, Pastor Jordan. And I'm like, oh, Lord Jesus, I don't know what to do. I got to remind myself, God, you are good. And so before we give today, before you guys head out and drop in your communication cards in the bucket, which please do that, just remind yourself that God is good. Let's pray. Dear Lord, I want to thank you for this day. I just want to say thank you, Lord, for the things that you have provided that we don't even know you have. God, the things that you have given us that we won't recognize until we see you on the other side. I thank you, God, for the things that you've given us in this life that we can see: family, friends, relationship, Lord, jobs, houses. But Lord, most of all, I thank you for giving us you. And I pray that as we give, we are reminded of why we give. Lord, because you first gave to us. In your name I pray. Amen.
Hey, so, you know I'm not great at these intense conversations, you know. You know I care about you, right?
I really care about you, too.
Well, it's just like things have been changing.
Change?
You know, when a relationship, it can start as one thing, but then become something different.
Different? No. I will not be broken up with again. Let me help you out with your intense conversation.
I sense anger. I had no idea you felt that way. Listen, 5'7" is a very adequate height. Staying in your parents' basement, that's a great way to save money. I am not cheap. I tried being vegan. Isaac Newton was 5'7". Those are my feelings being tap danced on. I had no idea you could be so hurtful. You sing all these mean things to me, and you don't like my music? I don't even know.
Well, I think I've said it all.
I don't even know.
Do you have anything you'd like to add?
No reason I came here. Just...
Oh. Congratulations, guys. Oh, you're speechless. That means you nailed it. Can I take your picture? What a perfect moment.
That's what happens when we do not really listen and we just start spouting out, right? Well, last week we spent a lot of time on James chapter 1, verse 19, and we talked about taking note that we need to be quick to listen, very slow to speak, and slow to become angry. And we spent a lot of time on the listening and a lot of part on the anger. And I kind of went through that mouth part really fast because today we're going to talk about the mouth. It says in Proverbs chapter 18, verse 21, death and life are in the power of the tongue. And I don't know about you, but when you get to a certain age, they say you have to have an annual checkup. Sometimes when you're younger, if you're in sports, they want you to have that annual checkup. Well, for me, I think sometimes we need an annual word checkup, because I don't know about you, but I have to be reminded sometimes that I have to watch what this is, what's coming out of this, because death and life are in the power of the tongue. And I don't know about you, but when I go to the doctor, they give you the whole questions, right? And sometimes don't you just dread the questions because you're like, oh, they're going to ask me if I'm exercising. They're going to ask me. They're going to make me get on the scale. They're going to make me, you know, it's all those questions. And but they do it so that they can help you, right? And so today, I'm going to be asking you some word checkup questions. Look at the first one. The first question for you is, do you carefully choose your words? Now, I imagine you had someone in your life, maybe it was mom or dad, or maybe it was grandma or grandpa, or maybe it was a school teacher, and they said something like this. If you can't say something nice, just don't say anything at all, right? Well, do you know what? Ephesians pretty much says that same thing. In Ephesians 4:29, it says, do not let any unwholesome talk come out of your mouths, but only what is helpful for building others up according to their needs, that it may benefit those who listen. Now, it's not in your notes, but look at on the screens. Look at what it says in the Amplified. It says this. Do not let unwholesome, foul, profane, worthless, vulgar words ever come out of your mouth, but only such speech as is good for building others up, according to the need and the occasion, so that it will be a blessing to those who hear you speak. Ephesians is pretty much saying if you can't say something nice, then don't say anything at all, right? You know, way back in the 90s, wasn't that a long time ago, 1990s, was when my husband, Pastor BG, and I came to GT. And just in case you're new to GT, my husband was the pastor here for years and was killed in a motorcycle accident in 2013. But in the 1990s, when we came, God just really put it on his heart, this little phrase, always build up, never tear down. Always build up, never tear down. He took it from these scriptures, but he just put it in a simpler profile. And he would say that all the time. And before I knew it, GT said it all the time. If you were to say, did we have a motto when we first came? Always build up, never tear down. That was it. And you know what? This week I was thinking that has kind of been the foundation that we started with. Always build up, never tear down. And we don't say it quite as often now, but it's still, I think, a foundation of our church. And you know why? Because we hear pastors from all over say that their congregations are always tearing people down, always complaining about this. And we don't have that here. And I really think it's because we established a long time ago, we're going to always build up, never tear down. Does that mean we don't ever make a mistake? No. But that means that was a foundation and should continue to be, because look at what the Bible says. It's important for us. I love the story that is told of a little-known program that they have in Congress that awards internships to kids that are just out of the foster care system. They are too old for that, but they give some of them internships. And it was early one morning when one of the senators walked into the office. He needed something in the mail room, and he walked in, and here was that young intern. He was the only one there, and he had been working all morning. He had come in real early. And the senator said to him, oh my goodness, this mailroom has never looked so good. You did such a wonderful job. Thank you so much. He went over to pick up some papers that he needed for a meeting, and he turned around, and the young man was standing there with tears rolling down his face. And he said, oh my goodness, did I say something to offend you? I'm so sorry. And the young man looked at him and said, no, my whole life, no one has said that I've done a good job, ever. Ever. Do you know that each of us have the power to build up and encourage somebody by the words we speak, and you can tear them down just as fast? 1 Thessalonians 5:11 says, therefore, encourage one another and build each other up, just as in fact you are doing. Now, the author of Thessalonians is Paul. And if you look further up, a little bit up ahead in the chapter, you'll see that Paul is talking about some tough times. As a matter of fact, he says, before Jesus comes back for his church, things are going to get pretty bad. He's writing that to the Thessalonians. But he could be writing that to GT Church right now, right? It could get pretty bad before Jesus comes back. And he could be saying something like, before Jesus comes back, crazy things could happen. Wildfires, hurricanes, a worldwide pandemic that is going to change the world. Yet, he is saying, keep encouraging each other. You know, BG's grandpa used to say this. When things got tough, he said, you got to keep on keeping on. Well, Paul's saying the same thing. You keep doing the right thing even when things are tough. And why don't we start looking for the positive and start magnifying it? It is so easy to get into that negative. And if you watch too much news, you're probably on that track of, that's all you can think about. And if you get on too much of social media, you're probably getting in that negative track. You've got to maybe take a step back and say, not going down that road. Things might be tough, and they're occasionally out of my mouth. I might complain about it, but I'm not going to go down that road. I caught myself the other day just starting to, I'm not going to go down that road. Because there's two things that we have to be careful that could infect us. You know, at the doctor's office, they want you sometimes to take precautions. And that is negative talk to and about others. Or wait, negative self-talk. Sometimes that's the worst. Negative self-talk. In James, it's not in your notes, but I'm just going to, you know, we were in James for quite a bit, and I told you that he talks about the mouth a lot. But in chapter 3, he says it's a deadly poison. And how do we bless God and curse men out of the same mouth? And he says that should not be so. So I wish I could give you a once and for all solution for dealing with this mouth of ours. But our mouth constantly has the potential for great good or extraordinary evil. And because the way we speak and listen determines the direction and quality of our life, of our family, our job, we have to be very diligent to guard this mouth of ours. So what are we going to do about it? We have to remember that we have power. Wait, we have power. You have extraordinary power and unlimited potential if we decide to surrender this to God and say, God, I want you each and every day to take what I'm going to say and help me not to say it wrong. Help me not to just tear people down. Help me to say things that encourage people. And here's what you need to remember as you try to become aware of how you speak. When you mess up, wait, I said when, because we're all going to do it. Wait, you might when you get in the car today, right? So when you mess up, we have to take ownership of it and say, I'm sorry. See, we have to own what we started with our words, those fires that could quickly get out of control. Sometimes all we have to do to stop the fire that you've started with your words is say, oh my goodness, I'm so sorry. I should never have said that. Do you know what? I'm sorry is a good thing to say. And sometimes we have to say, God, I'm sorry. That was not what I should have said. I'm a child of yours, and that's not what a child of yours should say. If you look at Proverbs 18:21 in the Amplified, it says death and life are in the power of the tongue. We started with that, but look at what it says after that. And those who love it and indulge will eat its fruit and bear the consequences of those words. Do you know there are consequences of our words, sometimes for years to come? For years to come. So number two, this could be a question that they ask you for your word checkup. Do you think about what you're thinking about? Wait, you're probably like, we talked about other things last week. I thought you were going to talk about the mouth today. But look at Matthew chapter 12, verse 34 and 35. It says, "For the mouth speaks out of that which fills the heart. The good man from his inner good treasure bringing out good things, and the evil man from the inner evil treasure brings out evil things." Have you ever heard anybody say, I don't know why I said that? Wait, maybe it's happened to you, right? But you know what this verse said? It says, well, most likely you've been thinking about that, and you just got it rooted down in here. And sometimes then you get mad about something, and out it comes. And before you know it, you're like, why did I say that? Because you've been thinking about it. Well, maybe it wasn't an hour ago. Maybe it wasn't a day ago. But you thought about it enough so it took root down in your heart. And then at a time where you were upset about something, it just came flying out. We have to guard what we think about so that we say the right thing. Because our words are the results of our inner thoughts. And you could say, listen to this, that our words are like a movie screen that reveals what we've been thinking about and the attitudes we have. And can you imagine when you came in this morning, we sit you down in a place and say, well, and we're just going to put on the screen what you've been thinking about this week. And then it'll be your turn, and we'll just put up on the screen what you've been thinking about this week. Because even though we don't reflect it to everybody, at some point we're going to. You know, I got to tell you, I have been working on messages on the mouth for a while now. And you know, then you really have trouble with your mouth because you're working at being good about the mouth. And I realize that I have a real problem with the mask because I complain about the mask almost every time I'm wearing it for some reason. You know, because I can't breathe. It's in my way. Now my glasses are fogged up. And I don't know about you, but I've had problems with the mask. But we are not by ourselves in that. Because in 1918, there was a flu pandemic, and they had to wear masks. My sister sent me a story about it, and she said, you might find this interesting. It was very controversial. Some people wanted masks, some people did not want masks. In some cities, they made it so that if you didn't wear a mask, they could arrest you. You could have a fine of $5 or $10 in 1918. That would have been a lot of money. Or as much as 10 days in jail for not wearing your mask. It was political. Imagine that. I can't even imagine. It was a political problem. Not that we have had any kind of problem like that, but isn't it interesting? And as I read the article, you know, they were complaining that there's a lot of them that complained about it. And I thought, you know what? People are just people, aren't they? It doesn't matter if you were in 1918 having to wear a mask or in 2020 wearing a mask. We're all wearing a mask and none of us like it, right? Yet sometimes it makes it worse when you talk about how bad it is. When you just keep saying, I just hate these things. I can't breathe. You know what I was thinking? Because I support a child through Compassion Ministries, and I got something from them that was talking about it. And as I was thinking, I thought, you know, I'm really silly to be complaining about a little mask. Because in the United States of America, we're so much more blessed than so many countries who are experiencing this and have no resources to help. They have none of the freedoms we have anyway, and it is just making life very, very difficult. So this week, maybe when we put our mask on, we can say, God, thank you that I live here and that this is a mild inconvenience and you're going to get us through it, right? You know, because sometimes we just have to realize that what we think about has caused some problems because we think about it so long it comes out in the Word. So what is our prescription that the doctor might give you for that? It's in Philippians 4:8, and it says, finally, brothers and sisters, whatever's true, whatever's noble, whatever's right, whatever's pure, whatever's lovely, whatever's admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. In other words, when those bad thoughts come, or when you start feeling sorry for yourself, or when you just are irritated about something, then you have to mentally say, I'm going to take a mental shift. And okay, so let me start thinking instead of some of the good things God has done for me. I have a place to live. I have air conditioning. I'm not in the heat. You know, there's all kinds of things for us to think about. And when we make a mental shift, that will change what comes out of our mouth. And it'll be a lot easier for us to put that in practice, to always build up, never tear down, if you are mentally saying, I'm going to think about good things. I'm not even just going to think about good things. I'm going to look for good things. What can I say that would be uplifting? You know what? Betty, I like the color of your shirt today. And I had thought that when I came out. I normally wouldn't say it from the platform, Betty, but I but I like that color. And do you know what? Sometimes we think that, but we don't ever say that. But sometimes what a blessing that is to people. What a nice thing to say. It just kind of gives you a little bit of a lift. What if when at Walmart, when they only have two checkers and the line for the self-checkout is like forever, and you're like, well, where am I going to go? I mean, and when you get up there, really, those poor checkout people, they're doing the best they can. It's not their fault that you had to stand in line, but how many people are taking it out on them? So what could you do? Maybe you could just go up and say, you're doing a great job. You know what? I know this is a tough time, and I just really appreciate you. Do you know sometimes you just need to say that to somebody? And if you think about it, why not say it? And what if we, and you might say, well, I don't ever think like that. Well, then let's start. Why don't you just say, okay, when I go into Walmart today, I'm going to look for one person that I can say something encouraging to. What if before my kids leave today, I'm going to try and say one encouraging thing to them? Well, you know, maybe before you start yelling at them, to say, get your backpack, get your shoes. Where's your shoes? How come you don't have your shoes? Sawyer! Go get your shoes on. Not that Sawyer, who's four, gets distracted, but maybe you could say, like she did yesterday, oh, you picked up, because he picks out his own clothes now. Oh, your outfit looks nice, because sometimes that is a real praise, because, you know, you never know with a four-year-old. But we have to remember, if it's good, uplifting, wholesome and pleasant, say it all you want to, but if it is evil or negative or critical or complaining, we have to kind of reel that in and say we're not going to go there. Number three, are you speaking blessing or cursing? And it's not in your notes, but Deuteronomy 30:19 says, this day I call heavens and the earth as witnesses against you that I've set before you life and death, blessing and curses, but now choose life so that you and your children may live. You know, when I look back over my life, I realize that my parents knew the importance of how they spoke to my sister and I without any teaching on it. My mom and dad, many of you know Pastor Bob and Darlene Hoover, and but you know him as pastor. He wasn't. Yeah, he wasn't as I grew up. He didn't go to school to be a pastor until I was married. So as I grew up, he was manager of a lumberyard. And they did not come to know Jesus as their personal savior until they were in their, well, I was in high school. I was in high school when they accepted Jesus. But way back, somehow, some way, they had figured out the importance of what they said. Because, see, many of you know my story that I was really, really sick as a kid. I almost died twice. Fourth grade, well, it was kind of a wash. I was in the hospital more days than I was in the classroom. If you would have asked me by my best friend that year, I probably would have said one of the nurses. So I had a lot of issues. But it's interesting because my mom and dad never said, you can't. Well, I mean, every once in a while, because I was going to do something crazy, and they didn't think that was wise. But overall, like, they didn't say, you will always. They never said, you'll never be able to do a lot of things the other kids will do. You'll never be able to get married and have a family because you're so sick all the time. And who wants to be with somebody that's always sick? You know, they never said, don't play the flute. Now, if you know about a flute, when I was in fifth grade, everybody was going to be in the band. Everybody was going to be in the band. So I wanted to be in the band, and I wanted to play the flute. The flute is called a wind instrument for a reason. That would be because you need air to support it. Well, what was my problem? Air. But they never said I couldn't. Now, I wasn't the first chair by far. I was way down further because of air support. It was hard for me to do it. But they never said I couldn't. They never said, Brenda, you're not going to be able to do this or that. They never said to me, Brenda, you're not going to ever have children. Because a doctor, when I was in junior high, I had a back injury, and the doctor said to them, she probably will never have children. And they never said that to me. They never said that over me. They never just told me about it. They told me after I had children. They never said that and spoke that curse over me. They never agreed with that and said, she's always going to be that way. They never said, she'll never amount to anything because how's she going to keep a job when she can't even stay in school? Looking back, there are things that maybe they should have done. Maybe they should have said, Brenda, the flute isn't the best idea. But especially when I got to high school band where you had to march and blow. Well, I could march or blow, but I couldn't do both. So nobody tell my band director, but I was just doing the keys because it was either that or carry me off the field, you know? But I'm so thankful that they spoke blessing over me before they even knew blessing is what they should do. Now, in contrast to that, when BG and I moved to Grays Lake, which is where we were before we came to Decatur, there was a gentleman that BG met with, and he started talking about his life. He was 35. He was divorced. And he just couldn't keep a job. He'd get a job and he'd have it for a few months and then he would get fired. And as BG talked to him, I'll never forget what he said. He said to him at one point, my dad always said I would never amount to anything. I guess he was right. And when BG came home, he said, I can't believe that's what he remembers his dad always saying to him. You'll never amount to anything. And that curse that he was speaking over him had come to what he was. And it took a lot to get him to understand that is not what your heavenly Father says about you. That is not who you are. But do you know what? Out of this mouth, we have the power to speak blessing to people that will encourage them to be their very best. We have the power also to curse them and help them see that they'll never amount to anything. I think in our life, we have to realize we have more power than we think. So what are you speaking forth over your life? Are you saying stuff like, I'm probably never going to get married. I'm in my 40s and I'm just never going to get married. God should have done it by now. I mean, are you going to say, God, I thank you that age is no limit. And it doesn't matter if I haven't seen it yet. If you have the right person, I know it'll come along. Are you always saying, I'm never going to amount to anything? Are you always saying, I can't do it or I won't try it because you don't think you can? What are you speaking over your own life? Are you saying, I serve a God that can do anything? So if he's put it in my heart to do it, I can do it. And sometimes you have to tell yourself, it isn't about me, it's about him. But if we constantly tell ourselves negative things about ourselves, that is what we'll dwell on. And that's what we will be. It says in James 3:10, out of that same mouth come both blessing and cursing. These things, my brothers, should not be this way. For we have a moral obligation to speak in a manner that reflects our fear of God and profound respect for his precepts. Do you know that when we say negative things about ourselves or other people, we have to remember, wait, we have a moral obligation to speak in a manner that reflects our Heavenly Father. Sometimes we have to remember who we are. See, I was a Hoover. I was one of the Hoover girls. We lived in a small town, and if I did anything, I was a really good girl, so I really didn't do anything. But if I had, it would have come back. And every once in a while, my dad would say, you are Hoover girls. And just so you know, I expect you to behave like a Hoover girl. I expect you to behave in that. I expect you to talk in that way. We were taught we had to respect our elders. There were certain things that my mom and dad expected of us. And sometimes we forget that our Heavenly Father, we're a reflection of him to the world. And when they see you and when they hear what you're saying, are they hearing blessing or cursing? And you might not be blessed yet, but what if you, listen to this, what if you're missing the blessing that God has for you because you're so busy talking about how bad it is? What if you miss the blessing he has for you because we're griping and complaining about where we are in life, and he is saying, wait, I'm over here with blessing and you are totally missing it just because of the negative way we are. So my challenge for you is find promises in the Bible and speak them over your life and your children and their children. You know, in the mornings, I will do that. And there's some scriptures that I have actually written down and some promises that I just declare. Joshua 24:15 says, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And do you know what I say? Ella Bennett and Sawyer, my daughter's older and loves Jesus and was up here on the praise team, and her husband loves Jesus, so I don't have to really declare that. But for Ella Bennett and Sawyer, they're 10, 9, and 4. I believe that they will always love Jesus and they'll always make wise choices in life. And I say that daily. 2 Timothy 1:7 says, God has not given me the spirit of fear. So sometimes I just walk around and say, God, in this pandemic, it's easy to be fearful, but God, you haven't given that to me, so I'm not going to be afraid. I'm going to walk with you and believe in you, and I'm going to trust you. Malachi 3:10 says that if I give them my tithes and offerings, that he's going to take good care of me, blessing me with abundance. And since I do that, even if I get a big bill, I'm just going to keep declaring that. I'm going to keep saying, God is blessing me. Ephesians 4:29, we started early on with that. And sometimes you just need to say, thank you, God, for our family. Our family always builds up and never tears down. Our church always builds up and never tears down. Why not start declaring what you're praying for to be true? And write them down and start saying, that's what I'm believing for, and that's the blessing that I'm saying over my family. Psalms 19:14 says, May these words of my mouth and this meditation of my heart be pleasing in your sight, Lord, my rock and my redeemer.
Chapter 6, verse 24, it says, the Lord
bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. And I'm going to tell you what the Amplified says as well. The Lord bless you and keep you, protect you and sustain you and guard you. The Lord make his face shine upon you with favor and be gracious to you, surrounding you with loving kindness. The Lord lift up his countenance, his face upon you with divine approval, and give you peace, a tranquil heart and life. We can come in agreement with that blessing, can't we? You know, it doesn't mean that blessing doesn't mean we're not going to have some tough times, but it means God's blessing and favor is upon you even then. So we're going to ask them to come forward. You're going to love this one.
Upon you.
Anybody, but we know Jesus, and He is there to help.
God, we are so thankful for that. God, let us go out today remembering what you have said. The importance of being your child wherever we go, representing you well. And God, help us to remember that you're always with us. In Jesus' name.